Ivan Illich, The Cultivation of Conspiracy. This is the second half of the 20th of April, when we're talking about Hadot, and the present is our only happiness. And then the second reading was on Illich, and this is an asynchronous lecture, obviously, for the Classical Values Senior Seminar, Philosophy as a Way of Life, Spring 2021 at Fordham University. Now, this is the assigned reading, and it was taken from the collected volume. You can see the editor, Lee Hoyanaki and Carl Mitchum here, published in 2002, which includes this text, The Cultivation of Conspiracy. We've earlier in class spoken about Illich in the context of his writings on You of St. Victor's Didascalicon, and students will recall that Illich was born in Vienna in 1926, and he died in Bremen, Germany, 2002. That means that his life spanned the range of the Second World War, which he lived through as a boy, and which occasioned his mother, a German Jew, to flee with her children, Ivan was the oldest, to Rome. This meant that Illich's childhood would span the cultural realm of the Austro-Hungarian Empire. We're going to get to that in a little bit. And he speaks of the merchant background of his family origins, including his Dalmatian father, in speaking on the occasion of his receipt. I have a slide for this of the, because this is actually a lecture that he gives, on as the occasion, 1998, on March 14th, the when he received the Culture and Peace Prize, which was awarded at the Villa Itchon. This is a picture of that very prestigious villa, as you can see, in 1998. Now, the late 1990s brought Illich several opportunities, and you get that when you listen to, or in this case, we are just reading, the lecture that he gave. Intellectual recognition of one kind or another tends to occur at the end of a lifetime, especially in the case of one so very accomplished as Illich was. We've already had occasion to emphasize some of his achievements when we were talking about his magisterial, I don't really have a better word for it, and we just mentioned it, in the vineyard of the text. That's where he offers his commentary to use Didascalicon, which was first published in German, im Weinberg des Textes, the subtitle Als das Schriftbild der Moderne entstand. And we had occasion to make reference to both Anne Carson and to Plato's reflection on the relation between the reader and the text, in addition to the spiritual culture that is the monastic culture of education and edification, and its mammary exercises and spiritual practices. In fact, as we recall, Illich is a glorious, ceramic, wonderful decor item from the Villa Itchon. And Illich spoke of sort of a running course or a running track for a monk, point to point to point. Reading Illich's acceptance address on this honorific occasion, The Cultivation of Conspiracy, is both familiar and strange. One advantage for us in reading it is that as students of his book, In the Vineyard of the Text, quite in addition to the locative, that's that running course that I suggested, as Illich tells us about his youth and the Adriatic, a better idea, which is what we realize reading this later text, if one's looking for retirement, than Bremen, where he, thanks to the efforts of the professor of sociology, his friend, Barbara Duden, winds up. It's also how he comes to be honored by the University of Bremen, as he tells us about its decan, its dean, his friend Johannes Beck, who also underscores the literal conviviality, which is not only the substance of the lecture, but also the constant concomitant, as Illich, and not only Illich, describes it, of his life among and with his friends. Now, the 1998 lecture that we're reading begins by recalling 1996, the year he celebrated his 70th birthday, with a special occasion at the university itself, celebrating the non-native but famous son of Bremen. Thus, we have one of the prime sources. This is really fairly significant because people writing about Illich, even people writing biographical accounts, can have a certain shock that Illich, whom we want, and this is, you can kind of think that here, would be an ascetic man, maybe a perfectly saintly Stoic, might, this is the shocker, have enjoyed a good wine. And that's what Illich tells us. He tells us that the mayor governor of the city-state Bremen had picked very old Burgundy from the treasures of the Ratskeller, and that's actually the Bremen Ratskeller. You can find that on page 234. And the edit, what's interesting is that right there at that occasion, the editor Lee Hoyanaki would have been present, one of his oldest friends. The spirit of spirits, wine, and the like will turn out to matter. Thus, Illich goes on to quote a word from the Burgermeister's Laudatio. That's the honorific things important people say on such occasions. And in this case, it was taken from something Illich said himself, reflecting that, and that's the quote. You can look at the text. Illich at 70, in his own words, had found in Bremen einen Zipfel Heimat. And you get a kind of translation. These can also be bits of almost croissant-like little breads. Something like, as he says, because that's what the word really means, the tail end of an abode. As Illich continues to muse on the formula, we have it right here, ein Zipfel Heimat. How could I have been induced to connect the notion of home with the long, dark winters of continual rain, where I walk through the pastures along the Würme that are flooded twice a day by the tide from the North Atlantic? I, who as a boy had felt exiled in Vienna because all my senses were longingly attached to the south, to the blue Adriatic, to the limestone mountains in the Dalmatia of my early childhood. Well, it's complicated. And the lecture we're reading is not that lecture. He's talking about another lecture in the lecture. We're talking about the Peace Prize, which is actually the subject of his talk. It's all about peace, independently awarded by an important coterie of citizens at the Villa Ichon. These are the burghers, the people who give him the second prize, the second award. These are the sons of trade. That is, these are merchants, or you could also say these are capitalists, rich people, those who are well off. And Illich connects with his audience, given his own background, which despite crucial and significant differences, also turns out to have included bourgeois commonalities. He says, as the eldest son of a merchant family in a free port city, so like Bremen, one that was caught between the contesting powers of Byzantium and Venice, I was born into a tradition which in the meantime has petered out, but now without leaving me sensitive to the flavor of the Hanseatic hospitality you offer. A very important historian's reference, Byzantium and Venice. And here's a map of the same sort of thing. You can imagine that given the constellation, the reference could be missed by many Anglophone readers. And that's also to say many who are not, as Illich was, a historian. And Vienna, where Illich grew up, is exactly to be found at the portal to the East, this older tradition. There he would meet a teacher who herself came from Bremen, who taught him to draw. This was part of an education for a young boy of his era. And Illich was educated at home, let's not forget this. And after 65 years, he still remembered the name he gave her, Mama Pfeiffer-Kuhlenkampf. She went with them on holiday to the Dalmatian coast, painting watercolors and the combinations. And she taught both all the boys who were there the chemistry of color, of atmosphere. And that's still on Illich's mind as the color of spirit and location, place. One summer, he says, she came along with us to Dalmatia to paint. Her watercolors still grace my brother's study. From her, I learned how to mix different pigments for the contrasting atmospheres of a Mediterranean and an Atlantic shore. There are different colors, clearly, for the Northern Sea. Color is important here, as the same language is, of course, and also a metaphor, color, for atmosphere. The interesting thing is that telling us these personal details of his life, Illich also speaks to the legacy of his own achievements, as this is the object of some contestation among his followers and those who had their own reasons for sharing in his conviviality. Here, we may think of the clowns, he teasingly remembers, who roast the notion as such tools for conviviality with a bicycle. I share also here, I have one, another image taken at an Illich fiesta, as it's called, back in 2016, as this may give you a sense of the atmosphere in two senses of the word, and that's in Bremen. There, it's important to note that although this fiesta was a congress, meeting of colleagues giving papers, and not less after 14 years, still reminiscing, that the same atmosphere of grace and generosity still seemed to survive. And this legacy, as I experienced it, I was there, quaint, I think, and of course faded, it was getting old, was also, just if we listen to Illich himself, no kind of accident, as he tells us, learned, and this is very important, and leisurely hospitality is the only antidote to the stance of deadly cleverness that is acquired in the professional pursuit of objectively secured knowledge. I remain certain that the quest for truth cannot thrive outside the nourishment of mutual trust, flowering into a commitment to friendship. Therefore, I have tried to identify the climate that fosters and the conditioned air that hinders the growth of friendship. Very interesting comment on our modern air. At issue is the conditions that are necessary for, conducive to, as this is also part of the network reflections on conviviality. That's thinking. Illich uses the language of a Denkerei, and because there's also an actual institution that's now called a Denkerei. It's closed, of course, in the interim, because at the end of 2011, December 3rd, actually, Bazon Brock, you see him here, the Fluxus artist, without reference to Illich, heaven forbid, adopts the title of a Denkerei for his own purposes, to title his own art action institute, Denker im Dienst, thinker at your service. Not a matter of conviviality, but entrepreneurial provocation in Berlin, in Kreuzberg. Illich, here we have a picture of Illich, it points to the stops and starts of conviviality, as there are as many challenges as there are disappointed expectations. Here he is in Guernavaca. I like this because it looks as if he has a kind of laurel wreath. It is in this sense that Illich compares and contrasts memories and expectations, all in all, under the rubric of atmosphere. Thinking is also the reason that we cannot think a village in the context of classical values, philosophy as a way of life, without also recalling that Illich is a kind of secret agent, both of a certain aspect of the holy as one might say, but not less of a critical philosophy of technology. And I would argue that in order to be worthy of the name philosophy, philosophy of technology, shouldn't be running interference for innovation to beat the band, as it were, but critical and reflective, and not less, if we listen to Illich, ironic. Of course, he says, I can remember the taste of strong atmospheres from other epochs in my life. And he goes on to say, I've never doubted, and it's even more true today, that a monastic ambiance is the prerequisite to the independence needed for historically based indictment. He doesn't say defend it, indictment of society. Only the gratuitous commitment to friends can enable me to practice the asceticism, so he was a kind of Stoic, required for modern near-paradoxes such as renouncing systems analysis, all the while typing on my Toshiba. And then, too, the same constellation also contained the seeds for growth and movement. He writes, and this is the reference to the Denkerei, that'll be Bazon Brock's Denkerei, but this is the Sinkerei, is more specifically Illichian, which is what he says he starts in Mexico, which 5 years later turned into the Centro Intercultural de Documentación, or CIDOC. In this introductory talk for today's celebration, Bundestag deputy, and that's the reference to the talk that Illich is giving, or which had other talks preceding it, Freimut Duve told you about it. In those years, Duve was an editor at Rowohlt Publishers, which means he took care of the publication of Illich's books in German, and several times visited him in Guernavaca. He told you, Illich says, about the spirit prevailing in that place, a climate of mutually tempered forbearance. They came together to put up with one another. And it turns out the candles matter, atmosphere. One leaves, this is why the candles matter, a candle burning for a guest, just as one leaves a plate for Elijah at a cedar. Illich writes, atmosphere invites the institutionalization that will corrupt it. You never know what will nurture the spirit of philia, or you can be certain what will smother it. Spirit emerges by surprise, and it's a miracle when it abides. It is stifled by every attempt to secure it. It's debauched when you try to use it. The language is by definition vague, as Illich seeks to speak of the spirit, and this blows, so we're told, whether it will. This means that we are not in control. In Greek, he explains, speaking of atmosphere, the words used for the emanation of a star or for the constellation that governs a place. Alchemists adopted it to speak of the layers around our planet. Maurice Blondel reflects its much later French usage for bouquet des esprits. This and those present contribute to a meeting. Now, the quote continues, as Illich says, I use the word for something frail and often discounted, the air that weaves and wafts and evokes memories like those attached to the burgundy long after the bottle has been emptied. And so we see his perspective. Smell, which is what he's really talking about, and the nose of a bottle. Importantly, so many of these reflections on emanations and constellations turn out to be reflections, as we noted Bremen and Vienna and Venice and Byzantium, not less reflections, not just that on air and spirit, but also on place. Genius loci. And Christian Norberg Schultz wrote a very important book on philosophy and architecture with that as a title and a subtitle toward a phenomenology of architecture. Illich's attention to this, we're going to come back to that, goes beyond our travelogue sensibility. He takes his nose with him in order to speak of aura. And why not, he says. To sense an aura, you need a nose. The nose, framed by the eyes, runs below the brain. What the nose inhales ends in the guts. Every yogi and hesychast knows this. The nose curves down in the middle of the face. Pious Jews are conscious of the image because what Christians call walking in the sight of God, the Hebrew expresses as ambling under God's nose and breath. To savor the feel of a place, you trust your nose. To trust another, you must first smell him. Now, there's a bit of awkwardness here, especially for certain sensibilities, and I'm using this in a double sense. And it's important because Illich includes himself among those with such sensibilities. Because prior to all of this is also the difference between Austro-German cultural and linguistic sensibilities and English. So he says, he tells us, linguistically, some of that sense of mimesis comes out in an old German adage, ich kann dich gut riechen, I can smell you well, which is still used and understood in German, obviously. But it's something, he explains to us, you don't say to just anyone. It's an expression that's permissible only when you feel close, count on trust, and are willing to be hurt. Notice the care of what's being said here, the odd and strange vulnerability we're willing to risk for love, for friendship, quite where the possibilities are open-ended. Once again, when you feel close, count on trust and are willing to be hurt. This is part of the reason Giorgio Agamben suggests that we could do well to call on Ivan Illich during the current political circumstance, that is, the global change in rule and power for the sake of, in the name of, supposed health security. By contrast, Illich stresses this willingness to be hurt as just this and nothing less than this is required for friendship and, of course, for love. And even more, for anything like taking note of or caring for our neighbor, that very Christian sensibility, let alone what's really at stake, and that is the least of our brethren. Illich continues because, of course, he's talking about ministering to those very brethren, the most vulnerable, because to minister to the vulnerable is never about sufficient or adequate stocks of protective personal equipment for medical personnel or teachers, but always about, this is also a point Agamben stresses, vulnerability oneself. He says, it presupposes the truth of another German saying, ich kann dich gut leiden. I can suffer, put up with you well. Ich kann dich gut leiden. You can see that those words have not altogether disappeared from ordinary speech, even in the age of daily showers. Useful to note, because here Illich draws more on the sense in which Nietzsche speaks in one of his early lectures on pre-Socratic philosophy of tasting, of smelling, as part of the word sapio, I taste. And that's related, of course, to the idea of philosophy. And that's a little different than the more neuroscience-minded, philosophical, this is Barwich, a recent text that she has published, What the Nose Tells the Mind, that's neuroscience, neurocognitive science, with regard to smell. Thus, Nietzsche writes, he's very different, speaking of philosophy, of the etymology of sophos, that is, sophia, etymologically is related to sapio, to taste, to sapiens, one who tastes, and surface, testable, how you can test or taste, sometimes in chemistry. Etymologically, it will be the connection between Nietzsche and Illich, but emphasizing the philosopher as a matter of artistry, think of the art of living, Nietzsche goes on to observe, whenever artists are called sophoi, according to Aristotle, it shows that wisdom must be the most superb and universal scientific knowledge. Wissenschaftis are the seven wise, the ancient seven sages in antiquity. We can gain, noting this, a certain insight into Herdot's notion of the philosopher as a topos, inasmuch as that which Thales and Anaxagoras know would normally be termed out of the ordinary, miraculous, difficult, divine, but useless, because to them it had nothing to do with humane goods. And is therefore a topos. Pax, which is Illich's theme, and the genius of plays, genius loci. Here, Illich tells us his own evolution as he spent time as a priest in South America. That would have been after his time at Fordham and in the north of Manhattan, Washington Heights. He was one of those dangerous liberation theologians who also walked the walk. These are rare, and it's dangerous to be such. He literally walked, but he also walked what he said. He walked the walk and walked the talk. Illich is concerned to tell us the very spirit, the genius of the place. Once again, genius loci, and you can almost see Christian Norberg Schultz, that's the cover of his book. Illich writes, I was in Peru in the mid-1950s on my way to meet Carlos, who welcomed me to his modest hut for the third time. But to get to the shack, I had to cross the Rimac, the open cloaca of Lima. The thought of sleeping for a week in this miasma almost made me retch. That evening, with a shock, I suddenly understood what Carlos had been telling me all along. Ivan, don't kid yourself. Don't imagine you can be friends with people you can't smell. That one jolt unplugged my nose. It enabled me to dip into the aura of Carlos's house and allowed me to merge the atmosphere I had brought along into the ambiance of his home. Now, what Illich never loses, what many missionaries, but also activists, green and otherwise, can miss, one cannot quite say that they lose this, as it's unclear that it was there to begin with, is an appreciation of paradox, what I called irony, but should also be named critical reflection. I have here an image, it's one of those Getty images by plane, as you can see, of the Rima itself, the Rimac, seen from the air, and as it's obscured both from the automobile arrays and footgoers. Zelich's theme is peace, not river sewage, concealed from view or not. Now, let's be careful to note, Illich does talk about sewers. He has a great book on sewage and cloacas and so on, toilets and the like. In H2O and the Waters of Forgetfulness, H2O und die Wasser des Vergessens, Revolt, as you see, which he was talking about. What's at issue is ambivalence. Perhaps this is especially true when it comes to peace. And these days, in an era of COVID health measures, such Orwellian doublespeak has reached a new level, as Illich here recalls and reminds us in the process of some of the double duty word war is peace can do. After all, most of the world in the 20th century is suffering from the enthusiastic acceptance of European ideas, including the European concept of peace. Illich needs the reflection here then, because it allows us to see this concept and its history. And so he goes back to a talk he had given. Another talk. The assembly, it's once a talk he was invited to give on peace, obviously, in Yokohama, it gave me a chance to contrast the unique spirit of peace that was born in Christian Europe with its perversion and counterfeit when in international political parlance, an ideological link is created between economic development and peace. And that's, of course, was something that Illich thought was, of course, counterfeit or bogus. I argued, he goes on to say, that only by delinking Pax peace from development could the heretofore unsuspected glory hidden in Pax be revealed. But to achieve this before a Japanese audience was difficult. It wasn't just difficult. He's going to tell us that he fails. The point is anti-development and also counterintuitive. This is the reason, he says, I dare to annoy you with the memory of that walk in the dusk in Peru with my nose full of the urine and feces emanating from the rimac. That landscape no longer exists. Cars now fill a highway hiding the sewage. The skin and scalp of Indians is no longer the habitat of lice. Now the allergies produced by industrial chemicals cause the itch. Makeshift shanties have been replaced by public housing. Each apartment has its own plumbing, and each family member their own, he says, a separate bed. The guest knows that he imposes an inconvenience. The stench of the rimac has become a memory in a city asphyxiated by industrial smog. Indeed. It's in search of freshness, as it were, down deep, that Illich offers us an elusive and complicated reflection. And to make that reflection, he brings back a word from Japan. The Japanese have an iconogram that stands for something we do not have, or say, or feel, right? It's not quite a letter because there's nothing phonetic here. Fudo. My teacher, Professor Tamanoi, explained fudo to me as the inimitable freshness that arises from the commingling of a particular soil with the appropriate waters. Illich doesn't name him, not here, but his sensei, his professor Tamanoi, would have known Tetsuro Watsuji, born in 1869 and who died in 1960, who was, and here I quote, a standard biographical entry, a Japanese philosopher who reflected upon the meaning of climate, or fudo, in the Sino-Japanese linguistic tradition. Watsuji sees fudo not merely as a collection of natural features, climatic, scenic, and topographical of a given land, but also as the metaphor of subjectivity, or who I am. Furthermore, this self-discovery through fudo is never private but collective, by referring to a phenomenological notion of existere, standing out in existence, to be out among other eyes. One can look further for a discussion of what Suji's milieu from a geographic perspective. I think I have an image of this here. Some books on this, Augustin Burke's offspring of Watsuji's theory of milieu, right? Fudo, and that's of course the translation. You can see Watsuji Tetsuro Fudo, le milieu, Fudo, Fudo, humain, and you can, this is a wonderfully appealing iconogram as Illich speaks of it. Or Martin Prichtel's beautifully titled, The Smell of Rain on Dust. It's relevant, to be sure, to note the focus on phenomenology, as this is the atmosphere of Watsuji's reception. Illich does phenomenology practically and not less hermeneutically, reminding us via philological, linguistic, etymological reflection, trusting my learned pacifist guide. He's there to talk about peace, just as he's talking about peace at the Villa Ichon. I started from the notion of fudo. It was easy to explain that both Athenian philia and Pax Romana, as different as they are from each other, are incomparable to fudo. Athenian philia bespeaks the friendship among the free men of a city, and Roman Pax bespeaks the administrative status of a region dominated by the legion that had planted its insignia into that soil. And Illich has recourse to this recollection of his visit to Japan, not only for cross-cultural reasons, but also because the very mention of his reflections and his lecture to them blew up in his face. This is like the internet joke recently making the rounds, because under lockdown, anything seems to amuse us, whereby Jacques Derrida, very famously for his long talks, speaks for more than an hour, and given his stamina, it could have been 2 or 3 hours, about cows. Le vache, right? But in English, he was speaking in English. And every Derridian, eager to listen to the master, took notes on his interesting opinions on cows, only to discover mysteries of French pronunciation, the French. Derrida was no exception, if you heard him, and I have, read English as if it were French, that the term is pronounced chaos, not chaos. Okay. A similar and more serious problem emerged as Illich, in his talk, offended Japanese sensibilities. However, he says, speaking about packs in the proto-Christian epoch turned out to be a delicate matter, because around the year 300, packs became a key word in the Christian liturgy. It became the euphemism for a mouth-to-mouth kiss among the faithful attending services. Pax became the camouflage for the osculum, from os, mouth, or the conspiratio, a commingling of breaths. My friend felt I was not just courting misunderstanding, but perhaps giving offense by mentioning such body-to-body contact in public. The gesture, up to this day, is repugnant to Japanese. Withal, the cultivation of conspiracy, of which Illich writes here, will center on the historical phenomenon and symbolic significance, just in the sense that Illich emphasizes that we can barely recollect the meaning of symbol today, of the very ritualistic kiss of peace, as some may have encountered this in the mass. Illich himself, a Roman Catholic priest all his life, he was, counter reports to the contrary, never defrocked, although he was subject to inquisition. And we know too that the decision of that same investigation was in his favor, which is, for anyone subject to such a thing, an extraordinary testament. It's this piece that Illich seeks to articulate in order to speak of spirit and atmosphere. Peace, however, he explains, not in any of the many ways its cognates are used all over the world, but peace in its post-classical European meaning. Peace in this sense is the one strong word with which the atmosphere of friendship created among equals has been appropriately named. But to embrace this, one has to come to understand the origin of this peace in the conspiratio, a curious ritual behavior almost forgotten today. Don't forget that Illich is a historian, and specifically a historian, the way all history has to be done, by means of the word, what's written down, the texts, the records that we have. And at stake, he will need to investigate what's meant by the kiss in the same context. So Illich goes back to the ancient Romans and their conquests, which also means their departures from their own homeland. The Latin osculum, as he writes, is neither very old nor frequent. It's one of three words that can be translated by the English kiss. In comparison with the effect affectionate basium and the lascivious suavium, osculum was a latecomer into classical Latin and was used in only one circumstance as a ritual gesture. In the second century, it became the sign given by a departing soldier to a woman, thereby recognizing her expected child as his offspring. At stake is the Here's Giotto, this is the kiss, Il Bacio di Giuda, this is Judas's kiss, 1303. The Eucharist, conspiratio. Historically speaking, in just this context of conquest, the mouth-to-mouth kiss became the solemn liturgical gesture by which participants in the cult action shared their breath or spirit with one another. And so we read, it came to signify their union in one Holy Spirit, the community that takes shape in God's breath. The ecclesia came to be through a public ritual action, the liturgy. And the soul of this liturgy was the conspiratio, explicitly, corporeally. The central Christian celebration was understood as a co-breathing, a conspiracy, the bringing about of a common atmosphere, a divine milieu. We've clearly thought this very carefully through, and we can begin to think on the meaning of conspiracy, and by doing so, we return to the notion of genius loci, which is what he does, literally speaking. The medieval town of Central Europe was indeed, this is Bremen, a profoundly new historical gestalt. The conjuratio conspirativa makes European urbanity distinct from urban modes elsewhere. It also implies a peculiar dynamic strain between the atmosphere of conspiratio and its legal, contractual constitution. Ideally, the quote continues, the spiritual climate is the source of the city's life that flowers into a hierarchy like a shell or frame to protect its order. Insofar as the city is understood to originate in a conspiratio, it owes its social existence to the pax, the breath, shared equally among all. Illich, who by beginning with a memory of his youth, remember the hyponymata that we've been talking about all semester, as well as of past addresses given in Bremen, once again, the use of hyponymata in practice, ties down his points for himself and for his listeners. And towards the end of his talk, he reminds his listeners once again, this long reflection on the historical precedence to the cultivation of atmosphere in late 20th century Bremen, that's here, seemed necessary to me to defend its intrinsically conspiratorial nature. His point is that we're all breathing together, all sharing with one another the same earth, the same air, the breath of life, what Illich calls pax or peace. At issue is both receptivity and critique, tolerance and generosity, everything we need in order to be able to live, to use Illich's language of conviviality, one with another. As Illich continues to explain, philia or friendship is not coincidental, but the enabling condition for this critique. I wanted to show, he says, why independent criticism of the established order of our modern technogene information-centered society can only grow out of a milieu of intense hospitality. One more time, and now the focus is all about the guest, what we are to offer in one of those rarest of words for love that we might remember from listening with Anne Carson at the beginning of the term eros, and with Illich philia, and in the vineyard of the text, and as many will also easily add to the list, agape. But Illich is talking about what we owe the guest as a host, as everything depends on the host, that is on welcoming the guest, the stranger, the critic, someone who thinks otherwise than we do, and this is hospitality. As a scholar, I've been shaped by monastic traditions and the interpretation of medieval texts. Early on, I concluded that the principal condition for an atmosphere propitious to independent thought is the hospitality cultivated by the host. Now, there's a colon there and we're going to go on, but note that you have to invite the other in. You must leave the candle burning and make a place at the table for the guest. It's up to the host, and it's up to the guest as well. This goes both ways. Thus, such hospitality, and now we can continue, excludes condescension as scrupulously as seduction, a hospitality that by its simplicity defeats the fear of plagiarism as much as that of clientage, a hospitality that by its openness dissolves intimidation as studiously as servility, a hospitality that exacts from the guests as much generosity as it imposes on the host. And that's the talk. And I end here with just one more of Illich's words, not conviviality, not peace, no, what Illich names Umsonstigkeit, that is, gratuitous grace, as this is the divine gift of spirit, Umsonstigkeit.